Good morning, students. We are in the continuity of dynamics of machinery. Today's topic is brakes and dynamometers. Then what is the, in the last video, we discussed about the clutches, and today's topic, the brakes. Then a brake is a mechanical device by means of which the artificial frictional resistance is applied to a moving vehicle member in order to retard or stop the motion of a machine. So the brake is a mechanical device which is used to stop the vehicle which is moving in the direction of forward or backward. So these brakes are also used to stop the vehicle which are quickly in a shorter distance. That is a mechanical or artificial frictional resistance. So we have to apply the externally to stop up the vehicle which is in the motion. So these brakes are also used to hold the vehicle at rest position on an inclined road against the pulley of the gravity. Then the major frictional difference between a clutch and a brake is that the clutch is used to keep the driving and driven member moving together, but whereas brakes are used to stop the moving member of a driving and the driven to control the speed of a vehicle. So these clutch is to give the motion to the vehicle, but whereas brake is to stop the movement of a vehicle. So this is the major difference between the clutch and the brake. Then construction. These a brake action, the starts as a brake pedal is depressed. There is a two set of members, the continuity, the brake of every vehicle. Both the clutches and the brakes have the same structure, that one member is directly connected to the axial shaft and that is becomes a rotating member, and the second member is attached to the frame or an axle housing, and thus it acts as a stationary member. So these brakes works by causing the friction between the non-rotating member and the disc or a drum that turns with the road vehicle. So which are rotating on the road, that is the wheels which are rotating on the road, that is to be stopped by applying a brake. So due to that, the friction produces the force required to slow down the vehicle. By means of friction, the brake converts the power of momentum, that is the kinetic energy of a vehicle, into heat. The heat produced or dissipated into the air around the brakes. So due to that, the heat produced between the road and the wheel, there is a wear of these tires which are material in the rubber. So, and what is the principle of braking? These brakes, when a vehicle, moving vehicle possesses a kinetic energy, that is converted into the heating energy as the application of brake. This heat which are created, which is created, that is to be transferred to the surrounding air. Without that, there may be a loss of energy, and it is a simple form. A brake comprises a stationary brake shoe with a lining of friction on it and a brake drum. The wheel is fixed due to the rotating drum, and the driver applies the force on the brake pedal that gets amplified and pushes the stationary shoe to make contact with the brake drum and stop its rotation during the frictional resistance. So whenever the operator or a driver applies the shoe pedal, that will directly pushes the stationary shoe which are to be contacted with the brake drum. Then these brake drum is of connected to the wheel, then the wheel automatically stop. With that, there is a frictional resistance. Due to the applying of brake, there is a heat generated which is proportional to the force being bring the shoe is in contact with the drum. So how much of heat or how much of frictional heat is delivered means how much of energy or how much of braking action you are applying on the shoe, and then it is directly connected to the drum. These are all connecting of directly proportionate. Then what is the purpose of a braking system? As we all of you know, these braking system is applying for the emergencies to bring the vehicle to rest in a shorter period of time and the distance also. To control the vehicle when it is in the hills and to keep the vehicle in a desired position after bringing it in complete rest when there is no driver. So when we are making a bike, we will apply the front brake or rear brake. At the same time, when a car, when it is comes to car, the brake, the car having a two brakes, that is the normal brake and the second one is parking. So when we are operating the foot pedal in a general during the regular operation, that brake we will call it as a service brake. So accelerator, clutch and the brake, these are the these are all the three items or three components majorly we are using in the regular operation. Then in emergency, it is operated by a hand lever while parking the vehicle. That is called the emergency brake, which is mostly used in the heavy vehicles from car to a lorry and a trucks also. Then the classification on different basis, that is method of actuation and constructional basis. Method of actuation means how the brake is applied. That means there is either mechanical brake or hydraulic brake and electrical brake and vacuum brake and air brake. And constructional wise, these are drum brake or disc brake. These are the only two what we can see in the outer look of a any body. Then coming to materials for braking. So what are the braking materials that we will discuss here? That is, apart from the constructional, the braking materials is also important for taking the heat. So the braking material, the material used for the braking lining should have the following characteristics. So it should have high heat resistance and have low wear rate and high heat dissipation capacity. It should have adequate mechanical strength. It should not be affected by the moisture or air or oil. The coefficient of friction doesn't change with the temperature what we are in the running condition. So mostly we are using the materials called for brake linings is cast iron, fiber on material, leather on material, bronze on cast iron, asbestos blocks. Okay, these are the major usually materials for brake lining. Then this is the brake materials and method of actuation. Based on that, we will go for the mechanical brakes. Actually, what we are performing in the normally. Let me see. These mechanical brakes or arrests the energy of a machine via force These are the most commonly friction. They uses the coarse and rugged material that is tightened against a body is in the condition. The friction based braking generates the high heat and some noises also. Degrading of all engaged surfaces occurs, so inspection and replacement is required. So there is a high amount of this is a high amount of loss of heat, so due to that the material will be damaged. So most of the cases we have to inspect how much of level it is reached, so we have to make it a replacement. So every time we have to go through that. And hydraulic brakes, as we know, it works on the principle of Pascal's law. With that, whenever the pedal is pressed, that is transmitted to the vehicle brakes through the pressurized fluid. Okay, whenever the plate is pushes or pedal plate will pushes, these will pressurize the fluid. The commonly used brake fluid is glycol ether or diethanol ethylene glycol. So heavy equipments uses these hydraulics. And electric brakes, these are also called as regenerative braking system in an emergency or recovery mechanism which slows a vehicle by converting kinetic energy into a form which can be easily used instantly or stored until needed. The electricity flow causes the magnets to push brake shoe on the drums and apply brakes. These are currently used in hybrid or fully electrical vehicles like Toyota Prius and Tesla Roadster and MG also. So vacuum brakes. The braking action is produced by creating vacuum on one side of the piston which pushes it and brakes are applied. The vacuum is created by using a intake manifold. In start, there is only vacuum on both sides of the piston. When we push the brake pedal, the atmospheric pressure is applied on one side of the piston, pushing it onto the another side. Then air brake. The air brakes usually compressed air to operate the braking system. When the brake pedal is pressed, the compressed air rotates the brake cam, which is in turn pushes the brake shoe to the drum for applying the brake. These are the mostly used in heavy vehicles like trucks or heavy loader vehicles. So to stop up this heavy type of vehicles, we have to go for this. Then according to the design, there are brake drums or disc or drum brakes or disc brakes. So apart from these are major types of brakes is radial brakes and axial brakes. In these brakes, the force acting on the brake drum is in radial direction. These radial brakes may be subdivided to external brakes and internal brakes also. According to the shape of friction of element, these may be block or shoe brakes and band brakes. Then axial brakes, one is radial and the second is axial. These radial brakes, the braking system is applied in the radial direction, whereas in axial brakes, these are the brakes. The force acting on the brake drum is in axial direction. The axial brakes may be disc brakes and cone brakes. This analysis will be similar to the clutches also. Then the drum brake. The drum brake, it is a type of a brake. The drum brake drum is anchored concentric to the axial hub, whereas on the axial casing is mounted on a back plate. So this axial hub or what is the casing which are mounted on the back side, the back plate is made of pressed steel sheet and it is ribbed to increase the rigidity and to provide the support. So hence, when we press the brake pedal, it pushes the brake shoe with the frictional lining to the drum. So this is the components of a drum brake. The brake shoe, this is the yellow color. What is the color we are showing here? The yellow color is the brake shoe, and backing plate and brake drum. So here it is just like a cup. Okay, that is the or cap. Okay, that is called a brake drum. And the lining, so lining material, what we are discussed now, it should not wear, it should have some properties of high resistance, that is which is made up of the asbestos or cast iron. Then a wheel cylinder, so the wheel cylinder and a return spring. So these are the springs. Okay, the shoe returning spring, that means the upperly we are having one shoe and lowerly we are having one more shoe. These two are connected with the springs. Then coming to disc brake, the disc brake has a metal disc instead of a drum. So actually we are having a disc plate instead of drum. So it is a flat shoe or pad located on each side of the disc. With that, these two flat shoes are forced tightly against the rotating disc. The friction between the shoes and the disc slows and stops the disc. These are the different parts of a disc brake: brake pads, rotor. This is the backing plate. Okay, backing plate. And this is the nipple, slip and nipple, and piston housing. Okay, wheel hub. Okay, this is called the wheel hub, and this is called the disc also. Then what is the parking brake? The parking brake is an emergency brake, is used to keep the vehicle stationary or to perform an emergency stop. Actually, this is available in cars or trucks. So more than three, that is more than three wheels, which will have the emergency brake. The parking brake will press against rear drum brakes mechanically with a force that is less than in the main braking system. So the parking brake will have the rear drum brakes mechanically with the force very less. We can maintain the all the four wheels in a constant or a rest position. So when compared with the conventional, that is main brake, normally what we are using to stop the vehicle, when comparing this, very limited pressure or limited force is required to stop all the wheels, or parking the brake is very less. When the lever is pulled, the hydraulic pressure forces the brake shoe to the drum for applying the brake. Then advantages of braking system. Advancement in the braking system is ABS, that is anti-lock braking system. So that is it is an automobile safety system that allows the wheels to maintain tractive contact with the road surface. So whenever this is, if you see, this is the braking system. When an obstacle, it prevents the wheels from locking up and avoids the uncontrolled skidding. So with that, without ABS and with ABS. So whenever we are making, see here, a car which is driving, it will begin braking. begin breaking, which is having ABS and which is not having the ABS. So whenever we applied a brake, we can take a distance of coverage after braking, it may be more. Meanwhile, we are having a ABS means it will not stop, sorry, it will not move the vehicle in a wronger direction. So it offers improved vehicle control and decrease stopping distance on dry as well as in the slippery surface. So with the ABS, we can control the vehicle, and at the same time, with a shorter distance only, we can stop the vehicle. Then, brake drum materials, as we now discussed, that brake drums are made up of a nickel iron casting. This metal gives an optimum rate of heat transfer and provides a good anti-wear qualities. And the scooter and motorcycle drum brakes are made up of cast aluminium with bonded cast iron liner. The lining have high temperatures of about 350 degrees centigrade without distortion and are of made of asbestos based material having high coefficient of friction, which is 0.4. There are different lining materials are there. It is a molded pulp and compressed fabric and woven. An advantage of disc brakes over drum brakes. We are having two types, that is disc brake and drum brake. The disc brake provides better stability since these have uniform pressure distribution. Over the pads than that of the brake lining. In the case of drum brakes, the increased temperature doesn't affect the disc plates much compared to the brake lining of the drum brake. The design of brake adjuster becomes simple because when hot, the discs expand towards the pad, causing no loss in pedal travel. The maintenance and repairs of disc brake is easy. Disadvantage is the disc brake assemblies are costlier than drum brakes. That is the parts what we are using or the components what we are using in the disc brake are very costlier than the drum brakes. Okay, if any braking system is damaged, means we can replace the shoes directly in the drum brake, but we have to change the entire assembly in disc brake. So the costliest brake is the disc brake, and the pads wear off fast compared to brake shoe lining of a drum brakes. The disc brake have higher brake pressure since the braking system will give the effective thing so that the brake pads are or very highly the brake shoe linings are of these disc brakes will be wear off as compared with the drum brakes. The complete protection to the disc from road residual is provided with great difficulty. So the higher temperature operates of disc brakes causes evaporation of the brake fluid and leakaging of the seal. So in case of cars fitted with the disc brakes, an external servo mechanism is required because these have no self-energy defect, such as an arrangement is not required in cars having drum brakes. And hand brakes can be installed on drum brakes because these have self-energizing effect. Disc brake offer difficulty in installing the hand brake. Then coming to dynamometers. These dynamometers it is a brake, but in addition to that it has a device to measure frictional resistance. Knowing the frictional resistance may obtain the torque transmitted and hence the power of a engine. So the brake is the dynamometer is also a brake, but it has to measure how much of frictional resistance is delivered. But the knowing the frictional resistance, that is directly from the torque transmitted. The types of dynamometers is absorption type dynamometers and transmission type dynamometers. And these absorption dynamometers, the entire energy or power produced by the engine is absorbed by the frictional resistance of a brake, and it is transformed into heat during the process of measurement. Absorption, in the name itself, the absorption, that is the entire energy or power produced by the engine is absorbed by the frictional resistance of a brake, and these frictional resistance is transferred to heat. Then transmission, this energy transmission means the transmission from one place to another plate, it is to be transmitted and it is used for some other work. So see, the energy is not wasted in the friction, but it is used for doing the some other work. So the energy or power produced by the engine is transmitted through the dynamometer to some other machines where the power development is sustainably measured. So we are simply in the olden days, for example, we can take in the olden days of bicycles, they are having a dynamo at the back side of the tire. That means we are fixing the dynamometer in the rear wheel. So there is a it is just like a bottle. On the top of the bottle we are having a cap like that. There the cap is of a rotary condition. So whenever the rear wheel, while we are cycling, the rear wheel is the power transmitter, that is called the driven. So this cap sized wheel will rotate. Due to the rotation of wheel, automatically the rear wheel will transmit its energy to stored in this dynamo. Then the dynamo is connected directly to the lamp of a cycle or headlamp of a cycle. With that, whenever we require the while we are cycling, this energy or which is stored in the dynamo will helps us to give a light when we are using in the night times. So this is the major importance of the dynamometer. So these dynamometers are of two types. Just now we have told that absorption type is again classified to prony brake dynamometer, and the second one is rope brake. This prony brake dynamometer, which is or of a simple form of absorption type dynamometer, it consists of two wooden blocks. So these are the two wooden blocks placed around a pulley. This is a pulley. So these blocks, two blocks placed around a pulley, fixed to the shaft of an engine, whose power is to be required to measure. So we have to measure the torque of an engine. Over that we have arranged a pulley. This pulley is supported, or around this two around the pulley we are placing the two wooden blocks up and down. These blocks are clamped by means of a two bolts and systems, bolt and nut systems. We have placed two bolts and system to where for operating these. In between these we are placing a spring system also. A helical spring is provided between the nut and the upper block to adjust the pressure on the pulley to control its speed. The upper block has a longer lever which is attached to its carrier and carries a weight of W at the outer end. So these are the weight and the distance A is maintained of L from the center of the shaft to the weight which is at the outer end. The counterweight is placed at the other end of the lever which balances the brake when unloaded the two springs. These two springs two supports or stops S and S are provided to limit the motion of the lever. When the brake is to be put in operation, the longer end of the lever is loaded with a suitable weight W and the nuts are tightened until the engine shaft runs at a constant speed and the lever is in the horizontal position. Under these conditions, the moment due to the weight W must balance the moment of the frictional resistance between the blocks and the pulley. So let us consider the weight of the outer end of on the lever is W, which is in newtons, and L is the horizontal distance of the weight W from the center of the pulley, that is capital L. The F is the frictional resistance between the blocks and the pulley, and R is the radius of the pulley, and N is the speed of the shaft, which is in RPM. So we need to find out the moment of frictional resistance or torque on the shaft, that is T is equals to W L, or simply we can say that is FR also. Then the work done per minute, that is 2 pi NT by 60, the work done per minute is called as brake power of an engine. That is called work done per minute is by 60, that is 2 pi NT by 60. The T is the torque, that is which implies W, that is the weight. Torque is nothing but the force into distance. Here the force is nothing but the weight, that is W, into L, how much of distance from the center, that is L, into 2 pi n by 60. This is the main thing. And what we have explained here, that is of the thing. Then another type of dynamometer is rope brake dynamometer in absorption dynamometer. This rope brake dynamometer is another form of absorption type. It consists of two or more ropes wound around the flywheel. This is a flywheel in that the rim of the pulley of the pulley fixed rigidly to the shaft of an engine. This is the engine shaft. Around that we are fixing the pulley, which is connected to that. The upper end of the rope is attached to the spring balance, while the lower end of the rope is connected to the dead weight of the machine, which is we can see here. This is the lower end of the rope, that is dead weight, and the upper end is connected to the spring balance. In order to prevent the slipping of the rope over the pulley, so since the pulley is a very smoother and the rope is to maintain a grip between the friction of the pulley and the rope. So in order to prevent the slipping, we have to place some small wooden blocks at some intervals. These are the wooden blocks at some intervals around the circumference of the flywheel. So these wooden blocks of the pulley, which results the content in that, in order in the operation of the braking system, the engine is made to run at constant speed. The frictional torque due to the rope mostly must be equal to the torque being transmitted by the engine. So the frictional torque due to the rope must be equal to torque being transmitted by the engine. So for operating at higher speeds, these flywheel which are of higher speeds, there may be a generation of certain frictional heat. In order to cool them, we are supplying a cooling water to a separate channel to cool the drum, so that we can maintain the flywheel in a smoother manner, and the rope is also be in a good condition. So with that we can get. So here, what is the brake torque is to be required means, simply we can say the dead weight is W and the spring balance reading is S, the diameter of the wheel is D, and the diameter of the rope is also be considered, that is small d, and N is the speed of the engine. So the net weight or the net load on the drum is W minus S, that is W is nothing but the dead load minus spring balance load. The difference is the net. Therefore, we know the distance moved in one revolution means pi d. So around the circumference means, that is called the pi d. So here the radius or diameter of the wheel is to, in addition to that, the rope diameter also be considered. So pi d means the diameter of the drum plus diameter of the rope, that is capital D plus small d into pi. Then therefore work done is load into torque, S into pi into capital D plus small d. So the brake power is to retard, that is W minus S into pi into capital D plus small d by into N, 2 pi N is the speed into N by 60. Suppose if it is the case, we are neglecting the diameter of the rope, then small d is to be eliminated, then W minus S into capital D into pi into N divided by 60. Then the transmission dynamometers. The transmission dynamometers are of three types. It is epicyclic train dynamometer and belt transmission dynamometer and torsional dynamometer. Then epicyclic train dynamometer. An epicyclic train dynamometer, it consists of a simple cyclic train of gears, that is spur gear, annular gear and a pinion, so which are having a spur gear and an annular gear and a pinion gear. So the highest one is the annular gear, which are of the size high, and a smaller gear called a pinion. Due to that, here the engine, the spur gear is key to the engine shaft and rotates in anti-clockwise direction. See here, the annular gear is rotating in the clockwise direction. These annular and spur gears are interrelated of a pinion. So the annular gear is rotating in the clockwise, then automatically the spur gear is rotating in the anti-clockwise. These annular gear is also keyed to the driving shaft and rotates in clockwise direction. The pinion or the intermediate gear will meshes with the both spur and annular gear. The pinion revolves freely on a lever. Then a weight W is placed at the smaller end of the lever. So that is W. The smaller distance, at a smaller distance of, that is L, which is from the center of the these concentric circles, that is concentric at the center, that is annular and the spur are concentric centers. The weight is placed at the smaller end of the lever, and the tangential effort P, the tangential effort P is exerted by the spur gear on the pinion and the annular tangential reaction of the annular gear on the pinion. So that is the main reactions or tangential efforts here creating is, one is pinion to spur, that is P, and pinion to annular. So these two are combinedly coming from the center, so it is 2P. Okay, then this, from these we are getting the relation as, for equilibrium of the lever, taking the moments about the fulcrum. So here the fulcrum is this is F, this is the fulcrum, we are taking the moments. So from F to, the weight is always be in the downward direction, that is W. From F, the weight is always in the downward direction. How much of distance from the fulcrum? That is W into L. Then whatever the remaining force, W into L is equals to, that is in the downward direction. We have to again assumption that that is in the upward direction. That is upward direction is 2P. Okay, P and P, that is totally it is a 2P. From center of the fulcrum, it is of distance, it is A. So 2P into A is equals to W into L. Then P is equals to WL by 2A, where R is the pitch circle radius of the spur gear in meters and N is the speed of the engine shaft. Then torque transmitted is PR, and the total power transmitted is 2 pi NT by 60 is the formula. Then torque is P into R into 2 pi N by 60. This is the formula for power transmitted through the system. Then belt transmission dynamometer, or simply we can say this is a Frode Thornycraft transmission dynamometer. So another name for belt transmission dynamometer is Frode or Thornycraft transmission dynamometer. These are the two authors who developed or find the belt transmission system. When the belt is transmitting the power from one pulley to another, So whenever we are having here, how many number of pulleys is there means the driving pulley to driven pulley. So here driving is the main, driven is the secondary, but these two, driving and the driven, are not be directly connected. These two are connected by an intermediate pulleys. So when a belt is transmitting the power from one pulley to another, the tangential efforts on the driven pulley is equal to the differences between the tangential in tight side and slack side of the pulley. So the transmitting power from one pulley to another, that is totally based on the differences between the tensions on tight side and the slack side, that is T1 minus T2. Then a belt transmission dynamometer is a transmission dynamometer. With that, the belt dynamometer is introduced to measure directly the differences between the tensions of a belt. While it is in running, a belt transformer, it consists of a pulley A, which is rigidly fixed to the shaft of an engine whose power is to be measured. So the pulley A is the driving wheel, which is rigidly fixed to the shaft of an engine whose power is to be measured. There is another pulley called driven pulley mounted on another shaft to which the power from pulley A is transmitted. So here we are developing the, or what is the energy we are getting from the driving pulley is to operate the driven pulley by means of the connectivity. So here the driving is not wasting, since the driving is connected to the engine where the power is created, that is to be transmitted to the driven wheels. But A and B are connecting by means of a continuous belt passing around the two loose pulleys C and D. These are the intermediate pulleys. So this A or driving and the driven is not directly connected with each other. These are all by means of a belt around the two loose pulleys C and D, which are mounted on a T-shaped frame. So this is a T-shaped frame where that is connected to CD. The frame is pivoted at E and it is mounted, is controlled by two stops, that is F and S. So these are the stops. Since the tension in the tight side of the belt T1 is greater than the tension in the slack side of the belt T2, then so the total force acting on the pulley is C is greater than, that is 2T, which is to be greater than the force, total force acting on the pulley D. So it is obviously that the frame causes movement about E in the anticlockwise direction. With that, for making a balancing of it, the weight W is applied at the distance W from E on the frame, which is showing in the figure. Now taking the moments about the pivot, that is E, taking the moments about E, so from E the weight W is applied at a distance L, and there is a tensions we are creating here. So by neglecting the frictions, we can get it the 2T1 into A. Okay, the E is the center, that is above the E we are having the two tensions, And below the E, we are having tensions T2 and T1. So these, for balancing of these, the totally is operated for taking the moments about the E is 2T1, that is 2 times of A, E axis. And then the again one more tensions are there, that is T2, which are is rotating in the clockwise direction. So these are the rotating the terms, and this is T2, 2 times of T2 into A plus W into L, where the dead load is applied at a distance of L from the E. Then T1 minus T2, by solving the formula, 2T1 minus 2 bracket of A, that is equals to W. Then by common taking a 2A, T1 minus T2 is equals to WL by 2A, where D is the diameter of the pulley and N is the speed of an engine shaft. Then the work done in one revolution is T1 minus T2 into pi D. And the work done per minute is pi d n. Therefore, the brake power of an engine is pi d 2 pi n t by 60. That is pi d n by n t by 60. There, the torque is T1 minus T2 into pi d n by 60. So, with that, we are calculating the belt transmission dynamometer. And then coming to torsional dynamometer, the torsional dynamometer is used for measuring large powers, particularly the power transmitted along the propeller shaft of a turbine or motor vessels. A little consideration will show that when the power is transmitted in the then the driving end of the shaft twists through a small angle relative to the driven end of the shaft. The amount of twist depending upon many factors such as torque acting on the shaft and the length of the shaft and the diameter of the shaft and the modulus of rigidity of the material which is used for the shaft making. So the torsional dynamometer is used to measure the large powers when along the propeller shaft of a turbine. So main thing is these torsional means torque acting on the shaft and what is the length of the shaft and the diameter of the shaft. These are the main three things we need to remember, and what is the material used for the making the shaft. These are the main things we need to learn or we need to know before going for a torsional dynamometer brake power finding. Then we know the torsional equation is T by J is equals to theta by L. This is the brake torsional equation for any shaft, where theta is the angle of twist, that is in radians, and J is the polar moment of inertia. For solid shafts, the diameter we can take it as capital D, then the polar moment of inertia, that is J, is equals to pi by 32 into d power 4. For a hollow shaft, the diameter may be only the difference, that is hollow is nothing but the external radius and internal radius. Therefore, the polar moment of inertia of a hollow shaft is J is equals to pi by 32 into d power 4, capital D power 4 minus small d power 4. From the above torsional equation, the power transmitted P is equals to T into that is 2 pi nt by 60. Then Bevis Gibson flashlight torsion dynamometer. It is a mostly used Bevis Gibson. It is a mostly used It depends upon the fact that the light traveling. So the light traveling, depending on the light traveling, we are getting the how much of torsion is applied on the shaft. So it is depend upon the fact that the light travels in a straight line through area of a uniform density and velocity of light is infinity. Since we know the light will transform in a straight manner, not in a curvy manner. So for getting this, we have taken up an experiment that two discs, that is A and B, are fixed on a shaft at a convenient distance. Apart, each disc have a small radial slot, and these two slots are in the same line when no power is transmitted and there is no torque on the shaft. So which are in the rest position, or no applying of power or no applying of torque, these are, the shaft is in the straight direction. Whenever a light is behind the disc and making a brightness, and it is fixed on the bearing of the shaft, at every revolution of the shaft, the flash of a light is projected through the slot in the disc. So we kept a light at the backside of the disc. Okay, during the operation of torsion, these light will transform through the shaft to the B disc. So then we can see how much of torsion is applied on the shaft. So an eyepiece E is fitted behind the disc B on the shaft bearing, and it is capable of slight circumference adjustment. Then when the shaft doesn't transmit any torque, that is at rest, okay, a flashlight may be seen every revolution of the shaft as the positions of the slit doesn't change relative to one another. So this is the in what we are seeing here, whenever we apply a light, so the direct the light, what we are seeing in the figure P, the light will transform directly through the, what, this is an eyepiece E, okay, directly, there is no difference between the slot. Then whenever the torsion is applied, torque is transmitted, the shaft twists and the slot in the disc B changes its position through the slots in the L. A and E are still in line. See here, the light L in the C, the figure C, the light is applied, the torque is applied on the shaft. With that, there is a light will pass up the slot available in the disc B, but the eyepiece is of differences with the slot available in the disc B. So due to this, that the light doesn't reaches the eyepiece. So if the eyepiece is in now moved around an amount equal to the leg of the disc B, then the slot of an eyepiece will be opposite to the slot in the disc B, what we are seeing in the D operation. See, so it will not passes through the eyepiece. Then what we have done is we have adjusted the eyepiece to pass up the light through the disc and the eyepiece. So when we see in the figure D, we can see how much of deflection or how much of torsion applied on the shaft for getting or for movement of these IPs from the initial condition, what we have shown in the figure B. So this IPs is moved by operating the microscope spindle, and by means of a scale and vernier, the angle of twist can be measured up to 0.01 of a degree. That is the scale of error scale of the vernier calipers. So up to now we discuss the brakes and dynamometers. The types of brakes is disc brake and drum brake, and what are the materials to make up the brake linings, and then what are the types of dynamometer, that is absorption dynamometer and transmission dynamometer. These absorption having again two prony and prony brake, and the thing, and transmission is also divided to three types. One is epicyclic and belt transmission and torsion dynamometer. Okay, with that we can get it the information about the types of dynamometers and what are the brakes also. Okay.